call it as capital structure. Now, it is majorly divided into two parts. One is the equity capital and the other is the debt capital. When we talk about the equity capital, we consider equity share capital, preference share capital, retained earnings and share premium. And when we come to debt, we talk about all types of loans. So let's understand, equity share capital is nothing but the ordinary share capital. Why we call it ordinary share capital? Because people like you and me, who are ordinary, who don't have their own businesses, want to invest in some businesses, a certain portion of investment, and become the owner or maybe the decision maker in the ideas of the business, we are called as equity shareholders or ordinary shareholders. These people have voting rights, they are treated as owners of the company, and they are involved in decision making of the companies. Next is the preference share capital. Preference share capital is issued to those people to whom the company prefers. So if I give you preference share capital, it means that capital was not given to general public. Those shares were not issued to the general public. I am issuing it only to a few preferred people. They are giving me money and buying these shares from me. These preference share capital don't have voting rights. They are not considered as the owners of the company, but they have preferential rights over receiving dividend. They will receive dividend first, and then equity shareholders will get the dividend. Next is retained earnings. Retained earnings is nothing but the reserves and surplus that we keep out of our profits. Every year when the company earns profits, it doesn't spend 100% of its profit in giving dividend or giving any other benefits to shareholders. It retains a certain portion of it as retained earnings to be used in the future for any contingencies or for further investments. So retained earnings are the reserves and surplus that the company has, which is also a source of capital. If I want to expand and I have my reserves, I need not borrow from anybody. I can use it for expansion purpose. And the last one is share premium. Now, what is share premium? When you issue shares, and if there is huge demand for your shares, you can issue the shares at a premium. So if the share is of 100 rupees and there is huge demand, many people are willing to buy it, you can issue it at a premium, and you can say, I am issuing the share at 110 rupees. So you are collecting 10 rupees more from the equity shareholders in the form of premium, because there is huge demand for your shares. Now this 10 rupees more that you collect, you cannot show it as your share capital. You need to show it separately as share premium, because as per Companies Act, you have been authorized to collect the share capital of certain amount, and you have taken permission to subscribe and issue that many shares of that amount. If you are issuing the shares at a higher amount and getting premium, you cannot show it as a part of your capital. We will show it separately as share premium in the balance sheet. But that is also the money that can be used by the company for investment purpose. And it will be considered as a part of equity capital. So these are the four things that come under equity capital. The next is the debt capital. In case of debt capital, the first one is the term loans. These are basically long-term loans that you take from banks or financial institutions or cooperative societies. Or you can even take it from general public in the form of issuing bonds, which we call them as debentures. So first part is term loans. Second is debentures, where you issue bonds to the public, and the public in turn will give you money for long-term purpose, which you can invest in your business. The next is deferred payment liabilities. Now, deferred payment liability is nothing but a liability which you have to pay, but not right now. You can defer it, you can pay it later. So when you're going to pay it later, that money is lying idle. You can use that money for your business purpose, but you have to consider it as a loan, because that money is for that liability. You're using it now, so it's like you're taking loan and using it. And whenever that liability will come due, or whenever you've decided to pay it, you will have to pay that money. So that is deferred payment liability. Deferred means it is being deferred to the future or postponed to the future. I'm not going to pay it right now. The payment has got postponed. Next is other long-term debts. Any other long-term debts, you might have taken it from your relatives, friends, or any other source. those can be considered as debt capital. So your equity is divided into these two major headings, equity and debt, and under that comes all other sources of capital that we use. So now, what is an optimum capital structure and why are we studying optimum capital structure? Can anybody tell me how much debt and how much equity I should have? Can I take only equity all the time? Or can I only borrow? Yeah, tell me. Can I take only equity?
No, ma'am, we should. No, ma'am, there should be a ratio between equity and debt. Both.
There should be a ratio between equity and debt. Agreed. Why there should be a ratio?
To manage the risk, ma'am.
Okay, to manage the risk. Which is risky? Equity is risky or debt is risky?
Debt is more risky.
Debt is more risky. So if I take only debt, that means I'm taking huge risk. So can I manage that risk or no is a worry. So I cannot take only debt. So I'll have to take a combination of debt and equity. If I take only equity, what is the risk? There is no risk, no? Because all the shareholders are owners. If I don't pay, they will not say anything. And it is okay if I don't give them money. So what is the risk in equity? No risk. So why can't we go for 100% equity? Okay, if you go for, anybody?
Maybe due to tax payment, ma'am, I don't know exactly.
Tax is one of the benefits that you will get if you borrow, because when you borrow money, whatever interest you are paying on that, you will get tax savings. So tax benefit is one of the reasons why people go for debt. Another reason is if you go for 100% equity, you will lose your ownership and decision-making power. So suppose I start a company and I make all of you the shareholders. So suppose you all are 75 and all 75 of you are my shareholders. Now next time, whatever decision I have to take, it is as good as I have to take permission from all 75 of you, because you are also owners of my company. Now, if I need more money and I include more shareholders from 75, make it 100, so I have to take permission from 100 people. If I still extend my capital and I make 500 shareholders, I'll have to take permission from 500 people. So it's as good as I'm sacrificing my ownership and getting that money, because I am adding new owners to my company, and that will lead to delay in decision making. I will not have my own say in the company. I'll have to depend on you people, because you have the voting rights. If you vote against certain decision, I'll not be able to take that decision. So basically, we will lose ownership if we have more equity. If you have 100% equity, whoever is the maximum shareholder will come and sit on your chair and you will be kicked off. So that is the thing why people don't go for 100% equity, because they want power in the company which they have started. So they will take certain proportion of it as equity, and the rest they will borrow. Full borrowing also you should not do, because it's very risky. If you are not able to repay, the bank will sell your company and recover the money. So you cannot have 100% equity, you cannot have 100% debt. That means you should have a combination of both. Now, which combination is good? Should we have 50-50? Should we have 60%, 40%, 30-70? Nobody knows. So that is what we are going to study. That is, what is an optimum capital structure? What combination should I have? How much should be my equity? How much should be my debt? Now, how do we decide what is optimum? It's very difficult. No, somebody will say take 50-50. Somebody will say something else. But what is a quantitative way or the right way to tell which is the right optimum structure? So for that, what we have to do is we have to find the cost. What is the cost of equity and what is the cost of debt? After you get the cost of equity and debt, you need to combine equity and debt in such a way that you have minimum cost and maximum possible value. So I'll read the definition now and I hope you will understand it. It is the capital structure at which the weighted average cost of capital is minimum and thereby maximum value of the firm. Whenever the cost is minimum, it will increase the value of the firm. So you have to select such a capital structure where the total cost, we also call it as weighted average cost of capital, and we have done problems in this when we were doing financial management subject. So weighted average cost of capital is nothing but you are finding the total cost of capital including debt and equity. So you should select that capital structure where the WACC, weighted average cost of capital, is minimum, which will in turn lead to the maximum value of the firm. Okay, so the optimum capital structure minimizes the firm's overall cost of capital and maximizes the value. This is also called as appropriate capital structure, or it is also called as sound capital structure. So in exam, you can expect questions like what is optimum capital structure, or what is sound capital structure, or it can also be what is appropriate capital structure. So these are different names for the word optimum that are used in different books, but you should know the meaning. An optimum capital structure is the one where your total cost or weighted average cost is minimum and the value is maximum. Any doubts in this?
No, ma'am.
Let's go to the next. Now, what are the factors that will help you to determine should we have debt or should we have equity? This is a very common question asked in every type of exam, whether you are writing CA, CS, MBA, any commerce related exam. Usually the factors affecting capital structure, factors affecting working capital, factors affecting dividend decision, these three are most of the times asked, because these three are basic which every finance student should be knowing. So what are the factors that are affecting capital structure? Decision. How do I decide, and what all factors I should keep in mind before deciding whether I should go for debt or equity, or for a combination of debt or equity? So the factors are divided into two parts, internal and external. In case of internal factors, the very first thing I will see is the cost of capital. I'll find the cost of debt, I'll find the cost of equity, whichever is cheaper. If debt is cheaper, I will go for more of debt and less of equity. If I feel equity is cheaper, I'll go for more of equity, less of debt. Usually debt will be cheaper than equity. Now, few of you may say, ma'am, what is the cost for equity? It is just you give dividend or you don't give dividend, doesn't matter. But for debt, you have to give interest. So equity should be cheaper. That is not the case. Debt is always cheaper because we know that how much we have to pay for debt. 10%, 15%, 12%. In case of equity, you don't know what all you will have to spend. You will have to spend on issuing the shares, advertising it, preparing a prospectus, then giving the shares to the shareholders. You'll have to pay to the banker who becomes the merchant banker for you, his service charges. After you receive the money, you're going to invest it at different places. Whatever you earn, dividend should be paid out of it, which will be more than the interest that you pay, because that is a part of profit that goes to the owners. So equity is always costlier than debt. Is much cheaper. So you'll see what is the cost of, what is the cost of equity. That's the first important factor, and then decide which one to select, or a combination of both, what proportion to select. Second factor that you will see is the risk factor. When you talk of risk factor, debt is more riskier than equity, because tomorrow if you're not able to pay, the shareholders cannot come and close your company, sell your assets and recover. They will have to sit quiet because they are the owners. But that is not the case with the bankers and debenture holders. The bankers and debenture holders, if you are not able to pay, they will sell your assets and recover their money. So it's very risky to have debt, because you have to compulsorily repay it. If not, you will face the problem of closing down. Whereas equity is less risky. So if the firm has an appetite to take more risk, if the manager is taking more risk, he will go for more of debt and less of equity. But if the firm is risk averse is a person who doesn't want to take risk, he gets scared of taking risk. So if the firm is a risk averse, it will not take risk, it will take very little debt, and it will rely more on equity. So that is to be considered, the second factor. third factor is the control factor, which I explained to you some time back. If I go for more and more equity, I will lose control over my firm. I will lose control over my decision-making powers. So if somebody likes to have control, somebody wants to enjoy the powers, then that person or that manager or owner will go for less equity and more of debt. But if control is not a concern, you are ready to give control and still run the business, then you can think of equity. So that's the third factor. Any doubts still here?
No, ma'am.
Okay. The fourth one, objectives. What is the objective of the firm? Why the firm has started? That also depends on what you will do, whether you will take debt or equity and how you're going to run it. Okay. So if it is an firm which is started with the objective of making profit and gaining as much as possible, then that firm will be ready to take risk. It will go for debt and it will think of its own profit. The owner always bothered about his own profit. But if the objective of the firm is wealth maximization, thinking about the shareholders, then the owner will take a little risk, less risk, because he's answerable to the shareholders. He has to invest their money wisely, not put them into huge risk. So what objective is there to start the firm? On that also, it depends as to what are you going to do. Are you going to take debt or equity? Next is the constitution of the company. By constitution of the company, I mean when you register your company under Companies Act, you will have to submit something called as Articles of Association and Memorandum of Association. These are the two documents in which you will mention about what is your company, how it is going to function, from where you're going to take money, which sources you're going to borrow, what business you're going to do, which customers you're going to focus on. So these two are basically telling each and everything about your company. And when you're registering your company, you have to submit these two documents. Only then you will be called as a registered company under the Companies Act. So if you have mentioned in your articles or memorandum that you are going to, out of the total capital, you are going to borrow 30% through debt and 70% to equity, then you will have to follow that ratio of 70-30. Then you cannot consider any other factor. And if you want to change that ratio, you will have to amend your articles and memorandum with the permission of the Companies Act. Means you have to go legally, officially get permission, and only then you can do. So while setting up your company or while constituting your company, if you have already decided the ratio, you'll have to simply follow it, or else you can decide depending on the other factors. The next is the attitude of the management. With attitude of the management, we mean whether the manager wants control or no, whether the manager is ready to take risk or no. The first two factors that I explained to you. If the management is having an attitude of taking risk, they will obviously go towards debt. If the management has an attitude of having full control in their hand, then again they will go for debt. They will not think of equity. But if they are risk averse and they are not bothered about control, they will move towards equity. So who is running the show? Who is the management? Depends on them how much risk they can take or how much control they can use, and they will decide on the debt or equity. So these were all internal factors which were in the hands of the management of the company and which were controllable, and they could decide whether they want debt or equity or what combination. The next are the external factors. By external, I mean they are not in control of you and me. They are happening by itself and we have to take it as it comes. So the very first one is economic conditions. Now, what the economic conditions of India today is very poor. Reason, one virus came and it spoiled the entire economy because of lockdown. Everything got closed. The factories didn't manufacture anything. Nobody had to move out. There were no demand for goods and services. So that totally made the economy fall down. So such kind of conditions are external. They are not in our control. Now, in case of this, when the economic conditions are terrible and you want to take a loan or you want to start a new business, basically the interest rate will be very low because government also wants people to take loan and gear up, put money in the economy and manufacture more, produce more. So in case of this condition, you will get interest at lower, loan at lower interest rate. So you may go to borrow more instead of going for equity. But if it is a booming economy, if we are into growth states, we are expanding like anything, in that case, the interest rates on loan also will go on increasing. That time debt becomes costlier and then some people move to equity. So not only interest rate, the second point is interest rate, which is again related to economic conditions, but other things also come into picture in case of economic conditions. Like for example, if you are into a real estate business and you had planned to build up four more properties, expand, build four more properties and sell them in 2020, and you are going to raise money for it, you will halt that plan now. You're not going to raise any funds because you know that the conditions are pathetic. People may not buy real estate or property in 2020 because your businesses are not running well. So you might postpone the plan, or you might not take risk by borrowing more. You might think of equity, putting your own money or taking from equity shareholders and expanding because you don't want to take risk. So these are the economic conditions which you have to keep in mind. Interest rates, as I told you, the interest rates will keep fluctuating depending on the economic conditions. So if it is too high, you will go for equity. If the interest rates are low, you will go for debt. Policy of lending. Now, this is very important. Policy of lending, by this I mean is, what are the terms and conditions of banks for giving you loan? Or what are the terms and conditions of debenture holders for giving you loan? If the terms and conditions are too strict, too stringent, and you're not able to follow them, then you will not think of going into loans. It becomes a headache. So you will borrow less and you will go more so to get from equity. But if the terms and conditions are favorable, the policies are favorable towards you, and you're getting some government incentives, interest rates are less, you fall under some plans of government, you're getting subsidies, and the loan rates are too low, then you will think of going for borrowing. So policy of lending also matters. The next is tax policy. The more you borrow, the more you save taxes, because when you borrow, you'll have to pay interest. And when you're paying interest, you're basically saving taxes. So if tax policy is to be concerned, then debt will be favored more and equity will be favored less. And the last one is statutory restrictions. Statutory restrictions are restrictions put by the government on your company. If government has asked you not to borrow more than this, you cannot do it. Now, by government, I basically mean SEBI, Security Exchange Board of India, which is run through many people and it comes under the government's purview. If you are a company which is public limited and you have taken money from shareholders, and SEBI feels that you are borrowing more and more and increasing the risk of shareholders like anything, it can stop you from borrowing beyond a certain limit. So if any such restriction comes, you cannot borrow. You will have to stop and wait for the limit to get extended. So that is statutory restriction, compulsory restriction that you have to follow because you are staying in India. And you have to go with the law of India. You cannot say that, no, how can you put restriction? Then they will not allow you to do business in this country. So you should go by the laws of the country. If the laws of the country don't allow you to borrow beyond a certain limit, stop there and you'll have to think of equity. So these were the external factors which are not in our control. You can write the answers in your own words in the exam. What is important is to mention these points, because these are the important things that people think. You can also find many other answers on this in the books or on the net, and you can surf. That doesn't matter what points you're using, but on an average, whichever you search, these are the important points that you will get. So you'll have to study by understanding it. You cannot buy heart it. Okay, now the next is the theories of capital structure. I'll continue for another 15-20 minutes and then we'll wind up because I didn't give you a break. So let's start. Theories of capital structure. First, what we're going to study is the basic assumptions of these theories. Now, by basic assumptions, I mean these assumptions are applicable to all the theories that we are going to study. So what are those basic assumptions? We will understand. The very first assumption is there are only two sources of fund. One is the perpetual riskless debt and ordinary shares. So there are only two sources of fund. Either you can go for debt, or you can go for shares. This is an assumption. There are many other sources. You have angel investors, you have venture capital, and then anybody who is related to you can simply give you money and be a partner in your business. So there are different sources. But here, when we talk of capital structure theories, they concentrate or focus only on debt and equity, are the two forms of borrowing. And that too, it is perpetual riskless debt. What do you mean by the word perpetual? You have studied perpetuity in time value of money.
Continuous,
never ending. So here they mean till the company is alive, the debt will be alive. If the company closes down, they will pay back the debt. So that is what they're trying to say, perpetual debt. So till you are there, you keep paying interest. If you close your company, you pay your money and leave. So that kind of debt. But it is not true in real life. There are perpetual debts, but there are debts which have maturity period also. So both exist, but here they focus only on perpetual debt. And the next word, which is very important, is the riskless debt. Can debt be riskless? Yes, anybody, can you borrow without any risk? Can it be riskless?
No, ma'am.
No. So this is an assumption which is taken, which is not true in real life. If I remove this assumption, those theories won't hold good. So assumptions are basically, they have assumed these to be like this, but in real life, it may not be like that. Okay. Then there are no corporate taxes. Now, this is one big assumption which was taken, but it was removed later because this is an assumption which is so untrue that nobody can believe. Without taxes, the economy won't run, the government won't run, the country won't run. So it is not possible that there are no corporate taxes, but some of the theories assumed it, but later they modified the theories by removing this assumption. The dividend payout ratio is 100%. That is, the total earnings are paid to shareholders as dividend and there are no retained earnings, which is again not true. It is an assumption. Companies never pay 100% of their profit to the shareholders. They retain certain portion, which they can use in expansion or contingent planning. The total assets are given and do not change. The investment decision are, in other words, assumed to be constant. This is also an assumption. Here they are trying to tell you, once you decide you are going to invest 50 crores in the business, you cannot change that decision. You have to invest only 50 crores. That means you cannot go beyond 50 crores. So that is not true. If I have to expand, I can even invest 100 crores, 150 crores, depending on how bigger the size of the business grows. So your investment decision cannot be constant. It keeps changing depending on how fast you expand or you grow. The next is the total financing remains constant. The firm can change its degree of leverage either by selling the shares to retire debentures or by raising to debt. Let's not fall into it in detail. I'll tell you what it means. They say that the total funding remains constant. That means if I have decided 50 crore, I'm going to take only 50 crore. Now that 50 crore, how it will come, that proportion can change. I can take 30 crore debt, 20 crore equity, or I can make it 40 crore debt, 10 crore equity, or I can also make it 45 crore equity, 5 crore debt. So the combination inside that 50 crore can change, but the total remains constant. You're not going to borrow 1 rupee extra, or you're not going to take 1 rupee extra through equity beyond 50 crores. So your limit is 50 crores. Within that 50 crores, your debt equity proportion can change. That is what the assumption tries to say. The next assumption, EBIT is not expected to grow. What is EBIT? It's nothing but the operating profit or earning before interest and tax. So once they give you the EBIT, suppose the firm says, I'm going to earn 10 lakh every month or maybe 1 crore every year. That means that will be the fixed EBIT. It will not change, which is not true. You might earn 1 crore this year. You might earn 80 lakh next year, you might earn 2 crores next year. So EBIT keeps changing depending on your business and your performance. It cannot be constant. But here, the assumption says EBIT is not expected to grow. Once given, it's going to remain same. Next, all investors are assumed to have same subjective probability distribution of the future expected EBIT for a given firm. Now, this I will explain you with an example. All of you will give third semester exams, and I will ask you, can you tell me who would be the topper of the class? So will all of you give me the same answer, or the answers will be different?
Different.
Different. Different. Because, yeah, because each one of you have your own mind. You have your own thinking, your own perception. Some people may feel ABC will be the topper. Some people may feel XYZ will be the topper. Some people may feel I will be the topper. I mean, they themselves will be the topper. So each individual has different thinking ability, and depending on that, he or she will decide who would be the topper or who would come on the first position. But what this assumption is trying to say is each one of you will think in the same line, and each one of you will nominate one person only who will be the topper. So each one of you will say XYZ will be the topper of the class, which is not true in real life. That's why it is taken under the heading assumptions. Now here, the assumption doesn't talk about your class topper, but it talks about EBIT. So what it is trying to say is each and every shareholder will assume same EBIT in the future. So if I say Reliance will have an EBIT of 50 crores next year, each and every one of you will say Reliance will have an EBIT of 50 crores. You will not apply your own mind, your own thinking. Everyone will think in the same manner, and with the same probability, they will say that EBIT is going to be so much. Understood this assumption? While reading it, you will not understand. So I have to give an example and tell you what it means. Did you understand it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The business risk is constant over time and is assumed to be independent of its capital structure and financial risk. Can anybody tell me the difference between business risk and financial risk? Okay, are they both same? Yes, no, only that much. Is business risk and financial risk same? Yes or no? Just give an opinion. Maybe you're right, maybe you're wrong.
No, ma'am.
No, because the two words mean differently. When I talk of financial risk, I'm talking about borrowings, only borrowings, from where my money came and what is the risk that I have there. So I have to pay a fixed interest rate. Whatever interest I have to pay is my risk, because if I'm not able to pay, my company will shut down and my assets will be sold out. So financial risk talks about borrowings or debt, but business risk talks about overall risk of the business. Now, what do I mean by overall risk of the business? Your machinery may break down and your production may stop all of a sudden. That is business risk. Your employees may go on a strike and you will not be able to produce all of a sudden. That is business risk. All of a sudden, a new competitor, like let's take telecom industry. We had Airtel, Vodafone, Idea and BSNL on the top league, and all the four had competitive pricing. Each one of them tried to take as much as possible from the customers. But when Jio entered into it, literally killed all the four, and they had not imagined that Jio will come with such a business plan, and such a massive attack will happen that they'll have to merge. Literally Vodafone and Idea had to merge. So that is risk from competition, which is nothing but again business risk. So business risk will not think only from financial point of view, but it will think about the overall risk of the company, or you can also call it as operational risk of the company. Your day-to-day operations, your manufacturing, your production, your service rendering, when that goes into risk, we call it as business risk. And here what they're saying is business risk is constant over time, and it is assumed to be independent of its capital structure and financial risk. So they are trying to say business risk will be constant, which is not true. And they are also saying that business risk will have no impact with your financial risk, which is also not true, because if financial risk increases somewhere or the other, it has an impact on business risk. And the last assumption is perpetual life of the firm. So the life of the firm is never ending. this is true because the owner may come and go, the owner may die, somebody else will take over. So the life of the business is usually perpetual. If it is run properly, it can stay for years together, like the Tatas. It was run properly one after the other, so it's still there and it will still be there. But if the person who sits on the chair is not running it properly, the next one, whoever will come, then it may close also. So it all depends on who manages it, but usually we say life of the business is perpetual. So these were the basic assumptions. I've still not started with the theories. These are just the assumptions of each of the theory. So these are the four theories which I told you we will study: net income, net operating, Modigliani Miller and traditional. In the tomorrow's class, I will start with the net income approach theory. So it's very important to understand the theory. These are the formulas which I'll ask you to note down. And then we will start with the problems on net income approach. So I may take first 15 minutes or 20 minutes to explain the theory. And then last next half an hour will be for problems.